And welcome back to Let's Play Star Trek Next Generation of Final Unity. I'm the RPG Chick. Before we do anything else, which I'm not sure what we're supposed to be doing at this point, apparently we're at war with the Romulans.
Primary core access enabled.
Thank
Systems
you.
Online.
That's good to know. Gonna check out these entries in the computer. The codex. I love this song, by the way. I don't think I've ever heard, like, this version of the Star Trek theme, or Star Trek The Next Generation theme. What about you guys? It's the first time I've ever remember hearing this. Very, very nice. Atmospheric. So yeah, select topic from the list on the left. So I'm just gonna read through this stuff. I'll provide a link to skip. I don't think it's gonna take the entire episode, like 30 minutes, but you never know. So I'll provide a link to skip, unless it is the whole video. I'll put a annotation down here somewhere. So this is USS Enterprise NCC-1701-D. A Galaxy-class starship, it was officially commissioned on Stardate 40759.5, October 4th, 2363 AD, at Utopia Planitia Fleet Yards. Captain Jean-Luc Picard took command of the vessel on Stardate 41124. USS Enterprise is engaged in an exploratory mission as a representative of the United Federation of Planets. Its primary charter is to find and establish contact with new life forms. Systems. All right, primary systems within the Starship Enterprise. We got structure. Primary components. The hull of the Enterprise is made of a blend of strong, resistant structural materials and also contains conductors for protective and reinforcing force fields. SIF. Oh, structural integrity fields. This system creates a force field that reinforces the ship's structure, helping prevent it from distorting or collapsing when changing speed or direction. IDS, inertial damping system. Damping? I thought it was dampening. Damping? This system creates energy fields that compensate for acceleration forces, thereby avoiding fatal injury to the crew from rapid changes of speed or direction. There is a short lag time for shifting field direction and intensity, resulting in some uncompensated inertia from very sudden maneuvers or unanticipated velocity charges. That's when they shake the cameras around and people act like they're stumbling around on the deck. Bridge. Always entertaining. Gravity. Gravity generation network. Onboard gravitational fields are maintained by interconnected generator networks producing short lifetime gravitons. Okay, so we've got the bridge. The main bridge is on deck 1 of the saucer module. It is the command center of the ship during normal operations and of the saucer module during separated mode. It contains central seating and information displays for the commander and two officers. Forward, facing the main viewer, are stations for the operations manager and flight control officer. At the rear platform are the tactical control station and 5 workstations. Science 1, Science 2 and 3, Environment and Engineering. Duties. Commanding officer duties. The commanding officer carries out Starfleet orders and policy, interprets and applies Federation law and diplomacy, and is immediately accountable to Starfleet Command. The bridge command supervises all primary and secondary mission functions. Computers. The Enterprise's main computer system controls all normal operations of the ship. It processes displays, controls communications, and information. The crew interface to the ship's computer system is the Library Computer Access and Retrieval System. LCARS. Look at those LCARS go. There are 3 main processing cores. Each core, using miniature subspace field generators to process data at rates greater than light speed, really, is capable of handling all ship control and display functions. 2 cores are in the primary hull, and 1 is in the engineering hull. tricorder. The tricorder is a portable sensing, computing, and data communications device capable of analyzing most objects encountered on away missions and medical. The medical tricorder is a standard tricorder with a special medical peripheral attached. This attachment allows diagnostic scans of body medical conditions for most humanoids and many non-humanoids. Engineering. Engineering is responsible for the optimization, maintenance, and repair of the ship's systems. The engineering display monitors all ship systems, displays their current operational status, and allows allocation of power and supervision of repairs. The main engineering control center is in the battle hull. The bridge engineering station is linked to main engineering, allowing access to the engineering display and controls from the bridge. This station is normally unattended except when the chief engineer or senior engineers are on the bridge. Warp drive. Warp drive is used to move the ship at speeds greater than the speed of light. C. Copyright? Subspace field stress and field distortion generated by warp drives and other spatial manipulation devices, such as tractor beams and deflectors, are measured in Cochrans. Named after Zephyrin Cochran, a 21st century specialist who created the basic mechanism of continuum distortion propulsion using layered warp field coils. One Cochran is the amount of subspace distortion needed to exceed 1C, the speed of light. Okay, that's what C stands for. Warp 3 is 39 times C and therefore requires 39 Cochrans. Warp factors? Oh, we can move down. I haven't noticed this. Alright, so I'll let you guys look at this. Warp 9 is 1,516 C, Cochran's. Makes me wonder if I missed anything. I'll have to look out for this thing here. Okay, that was the first one. Subspace is the state in which a starship travels from point to point at warp speeds. Subspace is not completely divorced from normal space. Stars are visible from a ship in warp drive. They do seem to flow past the ship even when the ship is not traveling far or fast enough to justify such an effect by normal space rules. Subspace has its own rules, including its own speed limit, similar to the light speed limit in normal Einsteinian space. Anomalies. While subspace appears to be much more uniform in nature than normal space, hypotheses offer that there are occasional variations in its properties which could have very strange and perhaps undesirable effects on a ship in warp drive. The occasional appearance of an unstable wormhole and observation data on warp drive malfunctions support this theory. Vortex. Subspace vortex. One of many types of subspace anomalies, of which little is yet known. Vortices seem to be relatively stable in size, position, and effect, and to have no correspondence with anything in normal space at the same location. They are detectable as an uneven flow of energy through subspace. Proximity to a vortex while in warp can cause damage to the warp drive coils due to sudden changes in the warp field permeability. Now my voice is getting weird. We're ready. Impulse. The impulse engines are used to move the ship at velocities less than the speed of light. The maximum practical velocity using impulse engines is about 0.75C. Four individual engines form the main impulse engine on the dorsal spine of the engineering module. Two groups of two comprise the saucer module engines. Impulse engine reaction chambers, three per individual engine, burn matter fuel in fusion reaction. The resulting power can be used either for thrust or to produce power to run other ship systems, or be divided and used for both. Another four impulse reaction chambers serve as backup power generators for ship systems. Comms. Different communications devices used by the crew. Personal communicator. This small subspace radio device, formed in the shape of the Starfleet emblem and worn on the uniform, provides voice contact among crew members aboard ship and during away team missions. Universal Translator. The Universal Translator is a sophisticated computer program capable of real-time transition between languages. The translator examines syntax, vocabulary, usage, patterns, symbology, and cultural factors in a communication or language sample. A small language sample can distort meaning since usage, concepts, or vocabulary can vary a great deal. The translator continually updates the translation matrix during use. Federation policy generally requires extensive analysis before translator use. The translator is actually not very helpful in translating things that have meaning, which we're not aware of, such as Shaka when the walls fell. Subspace relays. Under ideal conditions, subspace radio signals can travel at speeds equivalent to warp 9.9997, at a distance proportional to the power of the signal. However, they decay to badly distorted light speed signals. With current technology, the maximum distance to decay point is 22.65 light years. To enable reliable long-range communication, relay boosters are used to rebroadcast signals at enhanced strength. Where manned stations are not available, untended relay beacons are placed so that boosters are located at a maximum interval of 20 light years. Transporter. The transporter is capable of moving personnel or equipment across short distances, such as from a spaceship in orbit to a planet's surface and back. This is done by dematerializing the person or object, transmitting them by a force field contained beaming, and rematerializing them at the destination. At the operator's console in a transporter room, the away team is assembled, their equipment chosen, their destination selected, and the transporter activated. No transports can be done when deflector shields are up or at warp unless the ship and target site are at the same warp velocity. Other barriers to transporter operation include strong atmospheric ion activity, various electromagnetic and other field effects, and large amounts of matter in the transporter beam path. Okay, I'm beginning to see this is going to be the entire episode. Sensors. The sensors are instruments that use a large variety of active and passive scanning techniques to gather information about objects near or visible to the Enterprise. At high resolution mode, sensors measure to approximately 5 light years. At medium to low resolution mode, they measure to approximately 17 light years. Located in the engineering hull directly behind the main deflector dish, the long-range sensor cluster is composed mainly of active scan subspace faster-than-light devices. Tactical oversees security of visiting diplomats, counterintelligence, armory inventory, and security team assignments. Tactical also commands weaponry and employs other emergency responses to celestial hazards and possible hostilities. The senior tactical officer also serves as security officer. In this case would be Lieutenant Worf. A starship represents the United Federation of Planets and its member nations. Officers and crew must anticipate and avoid potential conflicts. All other options must be exercised before using force. First contact requires cultural and technological assignment. Starships are rarely permitted to fire first against any threat. Weapons. Weapons capability available to the crew of the Starship Enterprise. Phasers are energy beam emitting devices used as tools and defenses. The term derives from... Well, I have an itch on my back. I'm trying to do it at the same time. Derives from phased energy rectification. Rapid nadions, short-lived subatomic particles related to high-speed interactions within atomic nuclei, release phaser energy. Shipboard phasers. The Enterprise has 12 Type X phasers. Each is an array composed of individual emitter segments, which combine to produce a beam of adjustable strength, direction, and speed. Or spread, sorry. Ship's phaser effective tactical range is 300,000 kilometers. Spread beams have a shorter effective range. The 12 phaser arrays, saucer module, dorsal ventral, and the battle section, forward and ventral, dorsal upper port, dorsal upper starboard, and dorsal aft port, dorsal aft starboard, ventral aft port and starboard, nacelle pylon port, and nacelle pylon starboard. Personal. Personal phasers are small, high-energy beam-emitting devices designed for personal use as tools and weapons. The standard Type II phaser has 16 settings. The damage index indicates the relative amount of physical damage done by the beam at a setting. So, light stun is a damage index 0. Medium stun, same. Heavy stun is damage index 1. Thermal effects, index 3.5 and 7. Disruption effects, damage index 15, 50 and 120, 300 and 450. Explosive slash disruptive effects is damage index 670, 940 and 1100 and 1430 and 1850 and 2450. There are many settings. Torpedoes. Photon torpedoes. Because phaser beams, being limited to the speed of light, are of little tactical use at warp velocities, there is a need for warp speed devices capable of delivering high energy loads. Photon torpedo engines are capable of maintaining the warp field level of the launching ship and accelerating within that level. They carry a Manti antimatter fuel cell, which powers the engine and can be detonated with high efficiency. Photon torpedo tactical range is 3,500,000 kilometers for mid-scale detonation yield. Both main torpedo tubes are on the engineering module. The forward launch tube is just above the main deflector dish. The aft tube is at the rear of the dorsal spine. At each tube, four loader stages can inject Manti, matter antimatter fuels into four torpedoes at one time and place them into the launcher. Up to 10 torpedoes can be launched simultaneously from each tube. Okay, science. The science stations are the first three aft stations behind tactical on the main bridge's upper level. Ops modes. Normal operations mode, green, is cruise mode with a minimum bridge staff of commanding officer, flight control officer, operations manager, and one other station officer. Yellow alert brings all active bridge stations into full enable mode. Ops curtails all activities that may hamper ship emergency preparedness. Red alert brings all bridge operations to full enable mode. Tactical systems are placed on full alert. Tractor beam. Tractor beams are beams of subspace graviton force that can tow or push objects such as ships or small asteroids. There are three main emitters, the steerable emitter on the keel at the base of the engineering hull fantail, a fixed emitter forward on the keel, and a fixed emitter on the leading edge of the dorsal above the photon torpedo tube. Smaller emitters are located near the main shuttle bay, near shuttle bays 2 and 3, and in each of the steering clusters. Oh, we got more shields. The tactical deflector system is the ship's primary defense. Deflector fields, or shields, produce a localized spatial distortion that acts like a physical barrier to objects and many forms of energy. Objects and energies within currently selected frequencies appear to bounce off the field, though they have actually had their velocity redirected by the spatial distortion. Raising shields results in restricted sensor scans, transporter system shutdown, and warp drive adjustments. Holodeck. The holographic environment simulators, holodecks, can realistically simulate almost any environment in the computer's memory and are used for crew training, recreation, exercise, and large-scale information display. Turbolifts. Personnel transport within the ship is provided by the turbo elevator system. The system's cars, turbolifts, are capable of traveling both vertically and horizontally through a redundant network of access tubes that connect all parts of the ship. Life support. The ship's life support systems are concerned specifically with maintaining crew, passengers, and other onboard life forms. And finally, astrogation. The flight control console, or CON, astrogation panel is used to check known information about surrounding space and to select a location or object as a flight destination. Sector. A sector is a cubic volume of space 20 light years on a side used for charting and navigation purposes. Federation charts divide all known space into named or numbered sectors. In the Kridnar navigation block, all sectors have a position number relative to the origin corner of the block. Main dish. Main deflector dish. Produces shields extending nearly 2 kilometers ahead that deflect stray atoms and particles. In addition, the dish produces a powerful beam that pushes aside larger objects thousands of kilometers ahead that would otherwise collide with the ship. Cool. I should have learned something about the main deflector dish. Very interesting. We're done with systems. Bridge crew. Current primary bridge crew of the USS Enterprise, Picard. Captain Jean-Luc Picard assumed control of the USS Enterprise on Stardate 41124. Service, First Officer, Mission Commander, and Captain on the USS Stargazer, Registry NCC-2893. Birthplace, Le Bar, France, on continental Europe, Earth. Two planets, Maurice Picard and Yvette Gessard. Education. Accepted to the Starfleet Academy in 2323 after his second application. Class President, Valedictorian, and Star Athlete. The only freshman cadet to win the Academy Marathon. Medical History. Bionic Heart. Interests. Horseback riding, racquetball, playing flute, fencing, Terran classical music, European and American literature, and archaeology and history. And they left off Earl Grey tea. Picard Maneuver. This battle strategy closes a gap between the ship and its attacker at maximum warp while firing all weapons and breaking off again at the same warp. This confuses the enemy, into seeing two ship images, developed by Jean-Luc Picard during the Battle of Maxia. Riker. Much shorter. First Officer, birthplace Valdez, Alaska, on continental North America, Earth, in 2335. Father Kyle Riker also serves in Starfleet as a civilian advisor. I don't like his father that much, actually. Service, Lieutenant on the USS Potemkin. Education, Starfleet Academy graduate, 2357. Interests are jazz and trombone. Commander Beverly Howard Crusher, M.D., Chief Medical Officer. Birth name Beverly Howard. Really? I never knew her maiden name. Birthplace Copernicus City, Luna, in 2324 to parents Paul and Elizabeth Howard. Service, found a cure for the Tsiolkovsky virus, I believe it said. Ligonese poison and the airborne virus. Partook in the first male Klingon spine transplant. Education. Entered the Starfleet Academy Medical School in 2342. Starfleet family. Widow of Starfleet officer Jack Crusher. Mother of Wesley Crusher. Starfleet Academy student. Interests. Tap dance. Data. Really, is this part of his name? Lieutenant Commander NFN... NMI Data? Second Officer. Second model android created by Earth cybernetics expert Dr. Noonien Soong. Birthplace discovered by the USS Tripoli at the Omicron Theta colony remains in 2338. Medical history. Positronic brain with an 800 quadrillion bit storage capacity, well, that's all, at 16 billion operations per second. Body composition is known to contain 26.8 kilograms of tripolymer composite, 11.8 kilograms of molybdenum cobalt alloy, and 1.3 kilograms of bioplast sheeting. Education: entered Starfleet Academy in 2341 after the Academy ruled he was an eligible sentient life form. Graduated with honors in probability mechanics and exobiology. Service: 3 years as an ensign and a decade in lieutenant grades. Awards include the Medal of Honor with clusters, the Legion of Honor, the Star Cross. First to devise a defense against the Picard maneuver. Android history: a first model named Lore has since been deactivated due to behavioral instabilities. You're not kidding. Lieutenant Commander Geordi LaForge, Chief Engineer. Birthplace: African Confederation, Earth, in 2335 to Edward M. and Silva LaForge. Service: as an ensign, he once served on the USS Victory under Captain Zimbada. Specialties include antimatter power and dilithium regulators. Education: Starfleet Academy Engineer Major Graduate in 2357. Medical history: bioelectronic vision device, visual instrument and sensory organ replacement, which stands, well, VISOR. It's an acronym for that. Connects to red light sensory implants at his temples for normal and thermal vision. Interest: scale model building and sailing ships of ancient Earth. I remember that, yeah. Worf, Lieutenant Worf, Chief Security Officer. First Klingon Starfleet Officer. Birthplace of Kronos, if I'm saying that right. Klingon homeworld in 2340. Orphaned at age 6 during the Kittimer Massacre and adopted by USS Intrepid Warp Field Specialist Sergei Rosenko and wife Helena. Raised on Galt until moving to Earth in 2351. Education: Starfleet Academy 2361 graduate. Medical history: first Klingon recipient of an artificial spine. You know, I was wondering if that was the Klingon that Crusher worked on. Family: elder brother to Kern, single father of one, Alexander. Lieutenant Commander Deanna Troi, ship's counselor and psychologist. Betazoid heritage enhances her empathic abilities. Birthplace: Betazed in 2336 to parents Betazoid Loxana Troi and Terran Starfleet officer Ian Andrew Troi. Education: psychology major at the University of Betazed. Karlstrom. I guess this is one of the... Yeah, these must be the ensigns that we can bring with us, the red shirts, I guess. Ensign Nils Karlstrom. Security officer. Birthplace: Oslo, Norway, on continental Europe, Earth, in 2341, to parents Gunnar and Helga Karlstrom. Service: first assignment, USS Enterprise. Education: Starfleet Academy graduate 2366. Interests: classical piano. Ensign Tamara Butler, engineering officer. Birthplace: Savannah, Georgia, on continental North America, Earth, in 2343, to parents Forrest and Wendy Butler. Service: first assignment, USS Enterprise. Education: Starfleet Academy graduate 2368. Interests are folk, dancing, and drama. And finally, for the USS Enterprise, support craft. Enterprise support craft. The Enterprise carries several small auxiliary craft aboard in three shuttle bays. These craft are used for repair work and for travel when the transporters cannot be used. The main shuttle bay is located on the primary hull saucer section, while shuttle bays 2 and 3 are located on the engineering hull, star drive, and battle section. Okay, I'm actually done with the Enterprise entries. We still owe this. My god. Sciences. Lists current mission items of scientific interest. Astronomy. Interest pertaining to astronomy. Planet. A planet... Yeah, we need to be told this. A planet is a body massive enough to be drawn into spherical or spheroid shape by self-gravitation, but not massive enough to trigger nuclear burning at its core. Smaller, irregular bodies are called planetoids or asteroids, or various other names according to their size and orbital type. Planets orbiting other planets are called moons, as are planetoids orbiting planets. Sol 3. Name: Terra Earth. Association: Federation. Status: Explored. Well, I would hope so. Class M, atmosphere standard mix, gravity 1.00 g, landmass 25%. Is that really the landmass of Earth? Just 25%? Yeah, I believe it. Radius 6,400 kilometers. Orbit is 157 million kilometers. Temperature 293 K. I guess at the core? That's Kelvin? Oh, yeah, I'm not familiar with Kelvin. Sentience, human, structures are cities, technology, interstellar, defenses, Class A. Class A defenses. I guess that's good. Classes. Oh my. All classes of planets. Planets' natural characteristics such as age, mass, and distance from their sun place them in 16 naturally bounded classes which have been assigned arbitrary alphabetic designations. 16, much like the phaser settings. 16 of them. A planet's distance from its sun relative to that sun's luminosity puts the planet in one of three thermal zones: hot, habitable, and cold. A planet's mass determines its internal heat generation and, in combination with its zone, its ability to hold an atmosphere. Some planets pass through distinct stages as they form and age, which may put them in separate classes. Okay, so we're going to read all this crap. This might end up being two videos so far. Class A planets, gas supergiants, are very large, typically 300 to 1,000 times the mass of Earth, and are in their sun's cold zone. Low solar radiation and high gravity have allowed them to keep thick atmospheres of hydrogen and hydrogen compounds. High core temperatures cause them to radiate heat. Okay, drink. Class B planets, gas giants, are large, typically 10 to 100 times the mass of Earth, and are in their sun's cold zone. Low solar radiation and high gravity have allowed them to keep thick atmospheres of hydrogen and hydrogen compounds. Class C planets are typically of about the mass of Earth, and in their sun's habitable zone. Due to the greenhouse effect of dense atmospheres heavy in carbon dioxide, their surfaces are very hot, and water is only found in vapor form, if present at all. Class D planets are typically of about the mass of Earth and are in their sun's habitable zone. They are newly formed, and their surfaces are still molten. Their atmospheres still retain many hydrogen compounds, as well as reactive gases and rock vapors. These planets will cool, becoming Class E. Class E planets are typically about the size of Earth and are in their sun's habitable zone. They are recently formed and their surfaces are thin. Their atmosphere still retains some hydrogen compounds. These planets will cool further, becoming Class F. Class F planets, again, typically about the mass of Earth and are in their sun's habitable zone. They are younger than Earth and their surfaces are still crystallizing. Their atmospheres retain small amounts of toxic gases. As these planets continue cooling, they may become Class C, M, or N. This is C. What was I? It was here. Class G. Class G planets are typically about the mass of Earth and are in their sun's hot zone. Their gravity allows them to retain an atmosphere of heavy gases and metal vapors, but due to strong solar radiation, their surfaces are very hot. Class H planets are small, typically 1 to 1/10 the mass of Earth, and are in their sun's cold zone. They are newly formed, and their surfaces are still molten. Their atmospheres still retain many hydrogen compounds, as well as reactive gases and rock vapors. These planets will cool, becoming Class L. Class I planets are small, typically 1/100th the mass of Earth or less. Due to low gravity, they have lost their atmospheres. Their surfaces, directly exposed to radiation and meteor impact, are typically lifeless and heavily cratered. Class J planets are small, typically 1/10th the mass of Earth, and are in their sun's hot zone. Due to a combination of weak gravity and strong solar radiation, their atmospheres are very tenuous with few chemically active gases, and their surfaces are extremely hot. Class K planets are small, typically 1/10th the mass of Earth, and are in the sun's habitable zone. Due to weak gravity, their atmospheres are tenuous, but water is usually present. Class L planets are small, typically 1/1/10th the mass of Earth, or in their sun's cold zone. Due to a combination of low solar radiation and little internal heat, their atmospheres are permanently frozen. Class M planets are typically about the mass of Earth and are in their sun's habitable zone. Their atmospheres contain significant oxygen, liquid water. Liquid water is a significant surface feature, and life forms are generally abundant. With more water, they would be in Class N. I think Class M is Earth, right? Fits in there. Class N planets are typically about the mass of Earth and are in their sun's habitable zone. Their atmospheres contain significant oxygen, liquid water covers about 97% of the surface, and life forms are generally abundant. With less water, they would be Class M. And somehow we're skipping to Class S. Class S planets, gas ultra-giants, are very large, typically 10,000 times the mass of Earth, and are in their sun's cold zone. Low solar radiation and high gravity have allowed them to keep thick atmospheres of hydrogen and hydrogen compounds. High core temperatures cause them to radiate visible light. These are the largest possible planets, as more massive bodies generate enough core heat to initiate fusion reactions and become stars. Class T planets, gas supergiants, are very large, typically 3,000 times the mass of Earth, and are in their sun's cold zone. Low solar radiation and high gravity have allowed them to keep thick atmospheres of hydrogen and hydrogen compounds. High core temperatures cause them to radiate enough heat that liquid water is present. Alright, we're done with planets and classes. A star is a body massive enough to trigger nuclear burning at its core. So we got all kinds of stars and stuff like that. Lazarus. A Lazarus star is a supernova remnant which, instead of being forced inward into neutron star mode, survives as a normal star. After expansion into red giant phase, Lazarus stars collapse and undergo supernova for a second time. A neutron star is typically type B0 and measures only a few kilometers in diameter. An early main sequence star that has completed the nuclear burning process often explodes. The reactive force of the explosion and the star's self-gravitation, eject shell electrons, as in a white dwarf and nuclear positrons. This leaves a neutronium core, possibly covered by a thin degenerate matter shell. Population. Population 1 and 2 stars. Population 1 stars are old stars well down the main sequence, class F, G, K, and M stars, and short on heavier elements. Planetary systems accompanying Population 1 stars primarily consist of gas giants without accompanying satellites. Population 2 stars are younger stars showing traces of heavier elements, hydrogen and helium. Planetary systems accompanying Population 2 stars include gas giants, stony worlds, satellite companions, and planetoid and comet shells. Red giant star. The red giant phase is common in the evolution of many less massive stars. When core hydrogen is exhausted, gravitational collapse ignites hydrogen shell burning outside the core. The star's envelope expands far beyond the photosphere limit. The star's atmosphere is extremely tenuous and relatively cool. Runaway star. A runaway is a star with a velocity significantly different from its neighboring stars. Supernova. When a massive young star exhausts its core hydrogen, it undergoes second-stage gravitational collapse. The resulting core temperature increase leads to runaway nuclear burning of helium, carbon, nitrogen, or oxygen, and an explosion that blasts the star's outer layers into space. Supernova explosions are the major source of metals and other heavy galactic elements. T-Tauri star. The T-Tauri stage is one manifestation of a star in formation undergoing initial nuclear burning. Dwarf is a category comprising various small and dim energy radiating or formerly energy radiating objects. A black dwarf is an object of stellar mass that has undergone gravitational collapse, reaching minimum potential energy and maximum entropy. Black dwarfs are subplanetary size and do not radiate. Drink. I feel like I should gargle here. A brown dwarf is a gaseous body producing much more energy through self-gravitation than it receives from the ambient medium, but which is not massive enough to initiate internal fusion reaction and therefore not truly a star. Brown dwarfs hot enough to produce visible light, substellar objects, are listed as Class S planets. Those producing infrared, thermal Edens, are listed as Class T planets. They are both also known as supergiant gas planets. Some giant gas planets, Class A, may produce slightly more energy than they receive, but they are not generally considered to be brown dwarfs. A red dwarf is a main sequence star of type M. The vast majority of stars in the galaxy are red dwarfs, small, dim, and long-lived. Also an excellent BBC television program. White dwarfs, primarily degenerate matter. This main sequence star, usually of type G to late A, has completed nuclear burning processes and has collapsed into a configuration roughly the size of a small planet. White dwarfs radiate at various levels of intensity through self-gravitational collapse. Nuclear burning occurs only on the surface through accretion of unburned matter from other sources. In such cases, nuclear ignition can regularly occur and is the source of the recurrent nova effect. The spectral class of white dwarf stars is usually prefixed with a D. I wonder what that stands for. And then we got spectral. Spectral types. There are seven major spectral types of stars forming a continuous band of types from 0 through M. Through M. O, B, A, F, G, K, and M. These are divided into 10 numbered subtypes. Subtypes, for example, A0 through A9 and then F0. Stars at the zero end of this band are hotter, around 50,000 degrees Kelvin, bluer in color, and more massive. Those at the other end are cooler, around 2,000 degrees Kelvin, redder in color, and less massive. A conventional code for star color is... Okay, so O is violet-white, B is blue-white, A is white, F is yellow-white, G is yellow, K is orange, and M is red. While a giant star may have a radius of up to 1,000 times that of Sol and be up to 100,000 times as luminous, most stars are in the main sequence portion of their lifetimes and have values near the typical main sequence ones for their type. Sol, Earth's sun, is type G. That's why I paused. I was like, we're type G, right? Its spectrum, as filtered by Earth's atmosphere, is the basis for standard illumination in human quarters. Interesting. Okay. So we've got basic values here, which I'm not going to read because that would be ridiculous. and we'll let you look at them. Pause the video. Here's our star, our soul. Hold on, guys. I had no idea it was going to be this long. Okay, phenomena. Da do 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 do. Phenomena. Okay. Subheadings are representative of different types of phenomena encountered in the home galaxy. I assume that would be the Milky Way. Asteroid belt, a toroidal Don't know this word. Toroidal zone around a star, usually at a distance where physical law predicts a planet. The zone contains a large amount of stony or metallic debris, ranging in size from microscopic to lunar. Blue stragglers. Hot, massive, bright blue stars found in the cores of a few globular clusters. Stragglers are formed by the head-on collision of two red giant stars. The increase of mass and fresh hydrogen mixture from the envelope into the new star's core causes the star to behave like an extremely massive young star, no matter the age of its progenitors. Star clusters are groupings of stars that are not just coincidentally close to one another. Stars in a cluster share some common characteristics, such as origin, galactic velocity, and so forth. The globular cluster is a very densely packed grouping of several hundred thousand stars, generally population 1 or I. Globular clusters define the spherical halo of the home galaxy. They are almost gas and dust free. An open cluster is a relatively loose association, okay, so that was 1, of several hundred years, generally population 2. The cluster is usually found in or near a spiral arm of the galactic disk. Open clusters presumably consist of stars formed from the same nebula at the same time. Such clusters are often associated with such nebulas or their remnants. Open clusters played an important role in determining the intra-galactic distance scale in pre-spaceflight times. Galaxy. A galaxy is any of innumerable large groupings of stars, typically containing millions to hundreds of billions of stars. Galactic core. The core of the home galaxy is formed from a supermassive globular cluster of stars. Interesting phenomena have been observed or postulated near the geometrical center, including an energy barrier similar to the one surrounding the entire galaxy, an intense radio source, SAG-A, a black hole massing several million souls, the so-called Great Annihilator. No official expedition has successfully reached the galactic core, though an unofficial one did so in the 23rd century. Sporadic communication with races in that area existed in the 24th century. Galactic disk. Consists of stars and matter orbiting in a plane around the galactic core. A large part of the mass and almost all the visible matter of the home galaxy exists in this relatively thin disk. Galactic halo. The halo is a spherical volume containing all the home galaxy mass. Most visible matter in the halo outside the galactic disk consists of globular clusters. Edge of the galaxy. While the home galaxy does not have a visually definable edge, the existence of an edge phenomenon, an energy barrier, was demonstrated in the 23rd century by a ship attempting to penetrate the edge nearest Federation space. Exploration vertical to the disk plane demonstrates that this barrier does not exist above or below the disk to a distance of several hundred parsecs. theories postulate that the barrier is spherical and surrounds the galactic halo. Really? The exact nature of the energy barrier is not known. So apparently we can't leave the galaxy? Spiral arm. The spiral arms in many galaxies are the visual traces of a gravitational density wave passage caused by a large number of very young, bright, and massive stars lacking in the more subtle regions of the galaxy. Contrary to popular belief, the overall numerical density of stellar objects in spiral arms is not significantly greater than in the less spectacular part of the disk. Matter. Some of the more exotic forms of matter encountered by previous starship expeditions. Dark matter. So-called dark matter is not really darker than other matter. The phrase refers simply to unreserved galactic mass. During the late 20th century, evidence indicated that the home galaxy mass was considerably more than could be accounted for by observed luminous or interstellar matter, also called missing mass. Yeah, that's what you're not supposed to do on Sunday. Degenerate matter. Hold on. Degenerate matter exists under temperature and density conditions such as the Pauli exclusion principle, or Pauli, prevents the formation of electron shells around the matter's atomic nuclei. Such degenerate matter is found in white dwarf stars and in the cores of some ordinary stars and planets. Degenerate matter is usually incredibly dense. A single teaspoonful would weigh tons. Wow. Negative matter. First postulated by the 20th century author E.E. Smith. Actual author? No reliable observation of negative matter has ever been reported. Unlike antimatter, negative matter has negative gravitons and repels ordinary matter. Upon contact, the matters would cancel each other out without release of energy. And finally, antimatter. Antimatter is similar to ordinary matter, except that its atoms are composed of positrons orbiting about antiproton and antineutron nuclei. Physical properties are indistinguishable from ordinary matter. When the two types meet, they convert one another into pure energy. The ability to construct antimatter, developed in the 21st century, made interstellar flight possible. Also called contraterrene or CT matter, which is archaic. Dyson sphere. A Dyson sphere is an artificially constructed sphere surrounding a star. Creation of such a sphere is beyond current Federation technology, but one such sphere has actually been discovered and visited by a Federation ship. Infrared signatures, presumed to belong to several such spheres, have been observed in Federation astronomical surveys. The canonical Dyson sphere would have an internal surface area many times the total surface area of all the Federation's inhabited planets. Damn. That is a large surface area. Quantum filament. A quantum filament is a closed loop of twisted space or fractal dimensionality with interesting and unpredictable associated physical effects. Unlike cosmic strings, quantum filaments do not pose major dangers. However, starship encounters with a filament are to be avoided. They are presumably generated in supernovas. Interesting. Nebula. A nebula is any region of space in which interstellar matter density is significantly higher than the average. Nebulas may result from stellar explosions or from pileup due to passage of gravitational density waves. Neutrino. A neutrino is a light, chargeless atomic particle. Deficit? Neutrino deficit? Excuse me. The neutrino deficit is the intermittent lack of solar neutrinos, presumably produced in stellar core nuclear fusion. fusion demonstrated to early 21st century astronomers that stars operate in a mode of dynamic rather than static stability. That is one hell of a sentence. Neutrino detector. The neutrino, a particle produced in many nuclear reactions, interacts weakly with other particles. It serves as an ideal tool for detecting, observing, and measuring many phenomena whose electromagnetic emissions would be shielded by intervening matter. Massive, cumbersome, and unreliable neutrino detectors were available as early as the late 1960s. The first practical detector was developed as a side effect of the warp drive. Panspermia? Panspermia theory. Originally proposed in the 19th century by the Swedish botanist Svante Arrhenius, hypothesizing that life is carried from planet to planet by spores. Otto Struve in the 1950s proposed a variation suggesting that life may be carried from planet to planet by intelligent, though not necessarily intentional, intervention. Proto-universe event. Oh god, there's so many. Proto-universe events are hypothetical events describing phenomena associated with a Big Bang in a parallel universe that obtrude into this universe. Such phenomena include severe space-time distortions, energy release, and formation of new matter. This may be the source of the white hole phenomenon. Pulsar. A pulsar is a rapidly rotating neutron star of non-uniform surface luminosity. When the area of maximum luminosity comes into view during rotation, the star apparently emits an electromagnetic radiation pulse. Pulsars are prized for their navigational utility. Quasar, quasi-stellar object QSO. A quasar is an intense and unexplained source of electromagnetic and neutrino radiation, invariably observed at a great distance from the home galaxy. One theory proposes that quasars are black holes of galactic mass in the process of absorbing the galaxies that gave them birth. Well, this time I thought a quasar was an actual, like, a kind of star. Same as pulsar. Well, that's a star. Rosa's limit? The distance beyond which a relatively massive and fluid satellite must orbit its primary to avoid being torn apart by tidal stresses. Stellar fusion ignition. When the self-gravitational force of a gas cloud overcomes its natural tendency to dissipate, the cloud begins collapsing. This increases gas pressure and in turn gas temperature. The temperature of a massive cloud will increase enough to trigger nuclear burning in the core. Interstellar or cosmic strings. Cosmic strings are extremely long gossamers of extraordinarily dense material, possibly left over from the asymmetrical forces of the Big Bang. Interstellar or cosmic strings are not superstrings, which are simply one physical model used to describe subnuclear phenomena, nor should they be confused with the similar but relatively innocuous quantum filaments. Cosmic strings were postulated in the 1970s. Lennox Cowie and Esther Hu observed the first cosmic string in the late 1980s. Did we? Wonder how much of this is fiction and how much is actual history. Good God, okay. Subspace. Subspace is the state in which a starship travels from point to point at warp speeds. Subspace is not completely divorced from normal space. Stars are visible from a ship in warp drive. They do seem to flow past the ship, even when the ship is not traveling far or fast enough to justify such an effect by normal space rules. I've read this already. Subspace has its own rules, including its own speed limit, similar to the light speed limit in normal Einsteinian space. While subspace appears to be much more uniform in nature than normal space, hypotheses offer that there are occasional variations in its properties which could have a very strange and perhaps undesirable effects on a ship in warp drive. The occasional appearance of an unstable wormhole and observation data on warp field malfunctions support this theory. I read some of this stuff, right? Subspace vortex. I've read this. Okay, skip that. Entropy. Entropy is a measure of any... Oh, that's the name of an episode of Next Generation. Entropy is a measure of any ship's disorganization, usually defined as the total number of accessible quantum states as weighted by their relative accessibility. The second law of thermodynamics states that as a closed system moves toward the future, its entropy cannot decrease. Time's arrow. This is a colloquial term for entropy, expressing its use as a means of distinguishing between past and future through the second law of thermodynamics. Von Neumann. A von Neumann machine is a self-replicating robot, originally postulated by 20th century mathematician Nachman Janos, also known as John von Neumann. The machine's sole purpose is to seek out raw materials and use them to replicate itself. Several self-replicating robot species have been encountered, e.g. nanites, but none with such a single-minded raison d'etre. Raison d'etre? I think I said that right. The Federation keeps a special watch for such species, especially after its experience with the planet-eating doomsday device that penetrated the Federation in the 23rd century. And different kinds of holes. Areas where space-time is discontinuous are known as holes. A black hole is an object with an escape velocity greater than the speed of light. Black holes range from the microscopic to galactic in size. Originally postulated by Laplace, in the 18th century and mathematically described by Zwicky and Oppenheimer in the 1930s, the first black hole, Cygnus X1, was observed in the mid-1970s. The first galactic-sized black hole, M87, was seen in the late 1970s. Tidal forces and subspace stress near black holes of stellar mass can be extreme. When matter falls into a black hole, short-wave radiation is produced and subspace stresses may intensify erratically. Also called collapsar. Never heard of that. White hole. A white hole is the opposite of a black hole, a hypothetical entity from which radiation matter are emitted, apparently originating from nothingness. This may be linked to the hypothetical proto-universe event. And a wormhole is a spatial discontinuity connecting two mutually remote areas of space. The generating mechanism is not known, but unstable wormholes do appear without apparent cause, as well as being occasionally created by malfunctioning warp drives. Recent discoveries in the Bajoran system indicate that stable wormholes can be artificially generated, though the process is not available to Federation technology. Quasaroid. Quasaroids are small objects with energy emission spectra similar to quasars. Their heavy radiation output makes them difficult to approach for study. Their origin is unknown, but it has been suggested that they may be stabilized white holes or artificial objects produced by an advanced civilization. Quasaroids often have very high velocities relative to nearby stars. Big Bang. The Big Bang is the hypothetical origin of a universe by expansion from initial state as a spaceless, timeless point of potential, one of a number of possible theoretical origins of our universe. Variables, or variable stars. A variable star changes in brightness over time. These fluctuations are usually caused by expansion and contraction of the star itself. Periodic variables are stars whose brightness varies on a predictable schedule. Irregular variables, such as their name implies, do not vary in any predictable manner. blue variables are unstable, extremely massive blue giant stars with very short lifespans. Cepheid variables? These are pulsating, highly luminescent stars. These play an important part in determining the extragalactic distance scale, since their periods are very strongly correlated with their absolute luminosities. That's it for that, okay. Huh. Moons are natural objects of planetary or subplanetary size that are in orbit about planets. Moons are classified using the same system that is used for planets. Glad they're not going into it any further than that. That's for all astronomy. Sheesh. Alright, I'm going to continue this in another episode. I've bitten off way more than I can chew here, my god. So, I'm gonna read again another episode. We'll see if I can manage it tonight. If my voice will last. I gotta get a better drink with which to coat my throat. Thanks for watching, you know. I totally understand if you guys skip these episodes, because it's really just me reading crap. But, yeah, if you have any comments, and you want to geek out with this stuff about astronomy and the Enterprise and such that I've read about, yeah, feel free to leave comments. Thanks for watching. See you next time, and enduring. Grow strong.